All right, so we are going to go ahead and get started. And today we're going to talk Introduction to Lubrication Excellence. We've got Terry Harris with us, industry expert. He could probably go on and on and on everything to do with lubrication, so we're happy he's going to try and give us some high-level information here in this 1 hour that we've got. And of course, he'll have his contact information to share with you towards the end of the presentation, so you can reach out to him and find out what else he knows, because it's a lot. Just a couple things. So UE Systems, we've been around for over 40 years providing ultrasound. We've got offices throughout the globe, and obviously one of the things that we love to do is hold these webinars for you guys, so we hope you find these valuable. If anybody's interested in some additional information about UE Systems, you can just pop a little note in the questions box and ask to receive our interactive information kit. I'll send that to you. Got lots of information about our different products, the applications that you can use ultrasound for, our software, and of course links to all these recordings of the webinars that we hold throughout the year. So definitely let me know if you want that. Before we welcome Terry, just some housekeeping. So as I said, there is that questions box. So if you've got questions throughout the webinar, feel free to type those in and we'll get those asked. Also, as I've said, we are recording this, so we'll have the link available probably on our website about Monday or Tuesday of next week, and I will email you all out that link so you know where to find it and when you can take a look at it. And of course, please feel free to pass that along to colleagues that you think would also benefit from what Terry has to offer for us today. So with that, I am going to toss the screen over to Terry and let him get going.
All right, thanks, Maureen. I'm hoping everybody's seeing the screen. And oops, I guess I got to click my. Okay, I'm hoping everybody can see the screen, and we'll get started. Again, my name's Terry Harris. I own a little small consulting company called Reliable Process Solutions. I do a number of different training programs. I'm the exam director for SMRPCO. I do RCM training. You can see lubrication audits, a lot of different things the company does with the goal in mind to help people extend their equipment lives by multiple times by understanding and using these processes at their facilities. You know, again, I always show this slide. I base this slide on all of my training. This is the PF curve, and it shows down on the left side there, it shows the reactive area of the curve. You know, finding failures by human senses, and you're only going to be about 10 or 15% effective or efficient when you do that. We have the predictive part of the curve using predictive technologies to find failures, you know, before human senses lets us know there is a failure. And here we can become 30 to 50% effective or efficient maintenance by being able to plan work, get the right parts there, and a lot of times minimize the failure by finding it at an early stage. If you take mechanical ultrasound and using their new grease caddy tool, you know, if we can find out a bearing that has a lack of grease or too much grease, you know, we can mitigate that failure of that component by applying lube or getting the right volume of lube in there. And on the left side of the curve, the proactive part of the curve, you know, doing lubrication excellence, which we'll talk about, you know, doing precision alignment and all these other steps here, we can become proaactive in maintenance and become 70 to 100% effective or efficient in our maintenance processes. Today we're going to talk about lubrication, you know, how to get started in lubrication excellence, what it means to companies. But you know, you got many of you may have heard this, and it's actually true. You know, 50% of all your rotating equipment failures are lubrication related, you know, by some something we do wrong or having the wrong lube, and we can eliminate most of these. I did a survey at a power plant in Delaware about 3 years ago. And since they had good CMMS data available, it showed that 58% of all their failures were lubrication related. Now, if you just think about that, if you think about your plant, and if you could eliminate 50% of all your failures or extend that that life of that component out 3 to 5 to 10 times, what that would mean to your maintenance process, what that would mean to your operating rates and your quality of your products. You know, and if you think about this, only eliminating 25% of those 50% failures is a huge number at any facility. So the things you're going to learn today about this introduction to lubrication excellence, if you apply these things, you're going to see results at your plant. you know, two main factors or considerations we need to determine when you're doing a survey of your plant to look at what you have is any failures associated with your lubricants themselves, which we're going to talk about a few of those today. You know, and one of those things I always tell people that new lubricants aren't clean. Many times new lubricants aren't dry. Many times the additive packages that are supposed to be in our lubricants are not there, or they're in the wrong quantity. So these are failures of our lubricants. And then we have failures associated with our processes. You know, is there moisture in your process? Is there foreign material particles in your process or around your process that can get into your lubrication or get into your components? So the processes we have of adding oil to equipment, adding lubricants, adding grease to components, all these things are going to be failure modes associated with our equipment that are going to cause shortened life and cause downtime of our components. I stuck these charts in the presentation today, being, you know, some operational failure modes, you know, loss of the lubricant, too much oil or too much grease, you know, particles, foaming of your oil from different reasons. Maybe it's moisture, maybe you don't have anti-foam in your hydraulic oils anymore, which causes the oil to foam. So you can see these are operational type failure modes. Your temperature failure modes, overloading, overgreasing, you know, having equipment installed where there's no air movement to cool it down. You know, having the wrong viscosity or too high a viscosity lubricant can cause high temperature. You know, improper cooling, you know, a lot of different things. And some of the ones we don't think about are thermal conditions like sunlight. At a plant I was at down in Texas, when we measured the temperature of pumps and motors in the morning before the sun came up, they were 85, 90 degrees. In the afternoon when the sunlight was on those components, they were 165 degrees. So we actually at this facility took some galvanized and made little shade covers on these and to lower that temperature down, because that's a failure mode of your lubricant when we pick up those higher temperatures. Your ambient atmosphere or any process heat are all going to cause temperature failure modes of our lubricants. You know, moisture failure modes, you know, ambient conditions, whether you're in a high humidity area or you're in an area of the country or the world where there's a lot of rain. Washdown practice is a big problem at food plants where we get moisture in our equipment and our lubricants. You can see the way we store it, lubricant storage methods. You know, I can show you hundreds of pictures I've taken around the world with, you know, drums of lubricant setting in the open, setting under lean-tos that have water, have foreign material on top. Those are all problems for the way we store our lubricants. You know, foreign material failure modes, you know, ambient conditions we have in our plants. You know, is there a lot of particles? You know, I do some work with Owens Corning, and they make roofing shingles. A lot of foreign material particles in those processes that cause failures of their components. Greasing practices where the guy's putting the grease gun on the Zerk and there's foreign material particles on top of that Zerk that we're pumping into the Zerk every week or every month. They're all causing failures and causing shortened life of your equipment. Particles in new grease. I don't know if any of you knew it, but there are no standards in the grease industry for grease manufacturers who make grease, so there's particles in your new grease. Now, particles, yeah, they're particles you can't see, but they're particles that can cause damage to our components. So there's very few grease manufacturers, I mean, companies that are actually making greases in the U.S. that are actually filtering the oil and taking extra procedures and precautions to make sure particles aren't in there. I mean, Hydratex is a company that I work with, you know, and they take extra precautions to make sure that they're not particles in their grease or in their soap and binders, and it gives a longer life to their equipment. Environmental contaminations, you know, leaky coils, lube practices, your lube storage area can create particle or create contamination of your lubricants with other products. How is your lube vendor storing your drums and containers? You know, is there any contamination there? Viscosity failure modes. We're going to look at this real quickly, but viscosity failure modes in our lubricants is huge, and we have to look at all of our applications in our plant and understand as the temperature goes up, the viscosity goes down, and it creates higher wear for our equipment components. This is a chart here that a lot of people don't understand in plants, and we don't realize that this is going on, but this is an ISO VG150 oil. It's only ISO 150 viscosity at 104 degrees, and you can see at 140 degrees, ISO VG150 goes all the way down to 58. At 175 degrees, the viscosity goes down to 28. I always have my customers, when I do the lube training with the maintenance guys, I say, what happens when a bearing's failing? And, of course, the temperature's going up, right? So as the temperature on that failed bearing or failed gearbox starts increasing, look what's happening to the viscosity of our lubricant. And many of you have seen in your careers in maintenance, you've seen bearings at 175 and 215 degrees F. Look what the viscosity of your lubricant's doing. It's, you know, at 215, when that bearing's failing, the viscosity is gone. It's down to 15. It's approaching the viscosity of water, and we're increasing the failure rate just by that temperature going up. Now, I know at one of the plants I came from, we bought some grease with some ISO 460 oil in the grease, and as they got hot bearings in their plant, they would pump some of the ISO 460 in there, and a lot of times that would extend the life of that component and cool it down because we were getting lubrication at that high temperature then. So many times they cooled down, and many times we were able to make those components last 2 or 3 weeks longer by being able to keep the right viscosity lube in that hot bearing. You know, the same thing, this is a chart here of hydraulic oils. I was at a plant just about a year ago, and the reason I made this up for this plant is because the original OEM recommended they use ISO 46 hydraulic oil, and when I went out and measured the temperature of the hydraulic reservoir, it was 150 degrees. Well, look what the ISO was on the oil. It was 22. So they had more leaks. You know, they weren't getting the performance out of their hydraulic system they needed to. We actually, on this unit, ended up putting ISO 100 hydraulic oil in there just to get the ISO code close to what it needed to be for the application. So you can see these are all things in lubrication excellence. We need to look at our equipment, look at what we're using, not always go by what the OEM vendor says we should use, because many times the OEM vendor does not know how we're going to use the equipment and what lube should be in there. So again, some lubrication excellence information that everyone needs in with the lube training. Here's some program failures. I've been at a number of plants where there's no lubrication program. They're just lubing based on time. They're lubing based on OEM recommendations. You know, and there's a lot of new technologies out there. Like I mentioned, the UE grease caddy. Excellent tool, or even the UE gun itself is an excellent tool for determining when we should lube and how much lube we should put in. And, you know, I throw that in all my lubrication excellence training because I've had such great success with the tools. You know, no procedures for ordering your lubes, no procedures for receiving, no procedures for storing them after you get them, no written procedures on how to handle them, how to get them from your storage containers to the equipment in a clean, dry condition. You know, no RCM decision process on how the component can fail and what lube should be in there. So you can see a lot of program failures, you know, two rows of them here. And many of these things, until you do the lubrication excellence training, people don't understand many of these things, like additive package depletion and things like that. And while I've got everybody on the call here today, you know, when we talk about additives in drums, if you're storing your steel drums on concrete, the limestone in the concrete can create a charge in the drum, and it can actually pull the additives to the bottom of the drum in storage. And many of your additives go to the bottom of the drum during storage anyway, just under normal conditions. So what happens when your maintenance person goes out there and he puts the pump into the drum? You know, that first 10 gallons he's going to get mostly additives in there, and the rest of the drum he may not get any additives in there. So what's that do to your equipment? Well, if they're EP additives, if they're foaming, anti-foaming additives, it's going to create problems with your equipment and shorten the life. No lubrication audit is one up here. You know, not following. I have a number of customers that do oil analysis, and they don't know how to reinterpret the data, or they don't follow what the oil analysis report's telling them. So there's some good training programs put on by Insight Services and oil analysis companies, R&G Labs, that teach people how to read the reports and know what's wrong with their lubricants so the components will last longer. So again, a lot of program failures on here, and you have this information in the presentation that you can use as you do a little survey around your plant to see if you need or see what your issues are with lubrication excellence. You know, when developing lubrication excellence products or processes, we're trying to eliminate particles in the lubes below 10 microns. We're trying to eliminate moisture in our lubes down to less than 0.1%. So lubrication excellence can teach us all how to do that. One of our failure modes we talked about was particles. You know, the average film thickness on a loaded bearing or a loaded gear when it's in operation, that space, that loop thickness is 5 to 10 microns. So any particles larger than 5 to 10 microns are going to create wear in our systems. So you can see how small particles we're talking about here. Red blood cells are 5 microns. That's the film thickness. Talcum powder is 10 microns. If each one of you stand up now in your office or your house and you go run your finger across a picture frame or a door frame, those fine dust particles that are on your finger are going to be 40 to 50 micron particles. Now, in a bearing or in a gear or in your lubricant, those are boulders, and your equipment are going to grind those particles up, and in the process of grinding those particles up, we're going to create wear. If you think about the size of these particles in relation to your human hair, the human hair is 80 microns in diameter. So we're talking about very, very small particles that we have to eliminate out of our new lubes, out of the lubes that people are taking around the plant, and out of the equipment we have operating in our plant. So again, a big challenge. Here's some statistics from Noria. As little as 1% moisture in a lubricant can reduce component life by 50%. Moisture levels in lubricants of 2% will reduce component life in your equipment by 86%. So you can see this is only a couple ounces of water in a 55-gallon drum. So very, very important to understand what lubricants or what moisture is doing to your equipment life. There's 20 different areas of lubrication excellence, from ordering the correct lubricant to storing to plant applications. And again, like Maureen said, I can talk about this for days, but we've only got about 30 minutes left here to discuss this, but we're going to review some of these things. You know, one of the key areas to start in is your ordering process. You know, develop some ordering specifications on how lubricants are ordered, why we're ordering a specific lubricant for an application, and then where we're going to store that lubricant when it comes in. You know, I go to many, many plants, and I've got lots of pictures of when I go to plants of the drum sitting outside, the 5-gallon container sitting outside, and that's the normal storage area. I've got other people that have put them under lean-tos where they sit in the sun half the day, and half the day they're not, where they're heating up and cooling down, and you're going to pull moisture. So we have to store our lubricants correctly. Ordering specification, here's some questions you can ask. You know, and again, this presentation, I can send it to you in a PowerPoint or a PDF afterwards, but these are always questions you need to ask in your plant. Is the person who recommends the lubricant order knowledgeable? Is the person who places the order knowledgeable? Are the lubricants purchased from a single vendor? You know, is there a method to verify what's delivered? Is what was ordered? Does the person who receives understand the storage requirements? Some good questions on ordering specifications. Now when you get the lubricants there, lubrication oil received in storage. You know, is there procedures on how to get the new lube stored when they're received? Are there other chemicals stored in the area? I've been in a couple plants. One of them was the plant that I operated for years, where we had a major failure of a high-dollar piece of equipment because somebody grabbed the wrong lube product in a lube storage room where things weren't correctly marked. And in that room, I remember going in there after that failure and seeing lab alcohol chemicals stored in there, lab chemicals and janitorial supplies. You know, nothing should be stored in the lube storage area except lubricants, so there's no chance of contamination. Making sure things are clearly labeled. So here's some questions you can ask in your lube storage receiving area. Here's a lube storage area at a facility that I was at in Canada. And I took this picture from a staircase that was there, but look at the lube drum stored here. Those bags are diatomaceous earth and silicone and different filter agents used in a process, and all those bags are stored around the lubrication storage area. So you can see the dust and dirt and debris, and you see open containers sitting there that these dust particles and these abrasive particles are getting into. And I stood up there one day and watched a maintenance guy come in, and he grabbed that yellow container and added some oil to it and went out in the plant. I followed him out there, and he went in and topped off a gearbox. So, you know, that it was understandable to me why their mean time between failure and a lot of their equipment was 6 to 8 months. Here's a precision storage area. This is a unit we built for a nuclear plant in South Carolina, where all their lubes were pumped through a filter cart into these containers. The room was air conditioned, heated, spill control, and these lubes here are going to stay clean and dry until the maintenance guy takes them out into the plant. And they had developed procedures to make sure they got into the plant in a clean state. So, again, extending equipment life was the whole reason behind this lubrication excellence program. Here's another customer here that we put steel tanks in their lube storage room. Now I don't prefer steel for storing lube. Some people think by fire code you need to, but here they're stored in steel containers. But again, an ambient controlled room with desiccant breathers, spill control, steel floor, and just a nice, neat storage area. Now nobody was allowed in this room except the lube technician. So again, lube stored in a way that we can get them to the plant clean. Grease lubrication storage. Some of the same things here when you're storing your grease cartridges or your grease containers. They need to be in an area where it's clean and ambient control. You know, many of your grease manufacturers say always store your grease cartridges on end. Well, the reason they tell you that, because they know you're going to store them in an area where it might be in your plant where it's 90 to 110 degrees, and the oil and the soap and binder will separate. If you store them in a room that's ambient controlled around 70 or 72, you can lay them on their side. You can keep the grease and lubricant evenly distributed through the cartridge, and you'll get better and longer life out of your lubes. You know, making sure you don't store lubes too long. I've got some charts that I can supply people on how long you should store different kind of lubes based on the temperature you store them at. Storage room controlled atmosphere. You know, one of the reasons about 4 years ago we started building lube storage room and helping people design lube storage rooms because of all these contaminants. We want to make sure the lubes are filtered. We want to make sure the ambient conditions are clean. We want to make sure the temperature is controlled. We want to make sure there's no humidity, especially like if you're in Texas and Louisiana along the coast there. You know, sometimes we put dehumidifiers in a room. But these rooms, you want them to look like operating rooms where you're storing these lubes so that we eliminate all these particles and all this moisture that's causing downtime or causing shortened equipment life. And I'll show you a few charts, a few slides from here about the importance of reducing particles and reducing moisture and extending your equipment life. Lube consolidation. I don't know the number of plants, I can't even count them, the number of plants I've been at where there's way too many lubes at the facility for what they need. I was at a plant in Baltimore a couple years ago. They have 22 different lubricants in lube oils and 12 different lubricating greases. Now, what was the chance of cross-contamination or somebody in maintenance putting the wrong lube in a piece of equipment? It was very, very high. So, you know, we were able to consolidate their liquid lubricants down to 10. We were able to consolidate their greases down to 4. And this is very important that you look at this when you're looking at lubrication excellence, making sure that we consolidate so we eliminate the chance of cross-contamination. And the more synthetic greases you can go to, the better off you're going to be in the consolidation process. Lube application equipment. You know, what kind of grease guns are you using? Are they all the same model? Now, recently we tested some grease guns at a plant. They had 3 different models. One grease gun with 3 pumps put out 4 times as much grease as another model of grease gun they were using. And what did their PM say? Give this bearing 2 shots of grease per week or per day. Now, depending on what grease gun the guy picks up, that could be 4 times the volume of grease going into that bearing. So again, make sure you use the same style of grease gun. Make sure you calibrate the grease gun. Know how many ounces or centimeters of grease are going into that component. You know, what kind of portable filters are they using? And we'll talk about filters later on, but you know, very seldom do people understand filters. You know, what kind of grease certs are used? Are there grease cert covers used? So the equipment that you use in your applications is really important to understand what that equipment is and making sure it's the right equipment to keep out particles, keep out moisture. Storage of your lube equipment. Just as important to store your grease guns and your funnels and your oil safe containers as it is storing your lubes. You know, if I go to plants, I was at a plant in St. Croix, the power plant. At every component in that plant, every rotating piece of equipment, there was a water bottle sitting there with oil in it. There was a couple Tide jugs that had oil in it that was marked hydraulic oil or gear oil. You know, and their lube storage equipment, it wasn't stored. Their grease guns were hanging off the back of golf carts, off the back of utility vehicles, covered with dirt, covered with dust. So we need to store our lubrication equipment, make sure it's clean and particle and moisture free. Written procedures. How important are written procedures? You know, and this question comes up all the time. You know, how important are written procedures for the airline industry when they're doing the procedures on the airliner you're going to fly on? Well, the airline industry's failure rate wouldn't be nearly as good as it is without written procedures. You won't see a mechanic out there working on an airplane without a checklist, without signing off on the things he's doing. And that helps eliminate failures. So again, with your lubricating oils, you have to have written procedures. You know, how much oil we need to add to the box, what kind of oil, you know, what's the size filter media used on hydraulic oils, you know, what lubricant goes into each piece of equipment. These are all important written procedures that must be at a plant for a lubrication excellence program to succeed. Grease written procedures. I changed this because the procedures for greasing a bearing and greasing components in your plant are completely different than your oil lubricated components. You know, are there methods to determine how much grease and how often? We talked about the grease caddy. We talked about the UE tool. We talked about doing some of the calculations that are available and how much grease and how often. There's all kinds of variables on how, what the frequency is, and majority of the time, I'd say over 50%, they are not what the OEM recommends because they don't know what the conditions are that their components are operating in your plant. Now, your plant oil practices, you know, and I do this as a walk-around survey, which you guys can do at your plant. You know, if you have, a lot of plants have written procedures, but when you walk around with the maintenance people, they're not actually following those procedures. You know, they're not cleaning around the fill point before they take the cap out. You know, they're not wiping off the dipsticks before they put them back in. These are all written procedures because in lubrication excellence, remember, we're trying to eliminate all particles. We're trying to eliminate all moisture. And then we're trying to eliminate ways that those particles and moisture can get into our loops and into our equipment. You know, is the application equipment, you know, is the grease gun actually clean or the greaser actually clean? So try to make sure if you have written procedures to develop them, there's a way to measure to see if they actually follow those practices. The exact same thing with your greasing practices. You know, are they following the written procedures that were developed? And they were developed for the reason of eliminating these lubrication excellence failures. Your plant housekeeping. You know, what's the housekeeping look like as you go around the plant? You know, is there dust piled up on top of your bearings? Is there particles piled up on top of your gearboxes around the fill ports? You know, your desk and breathers in it are, you know, is the life extent or is the life exhausted on that desiccant and breather? You know, I take pictures all the time at plants. I was at a plant one time that where I looked at the desiccant and breathers and they hadn't been changed so long that there was mold actually growing inside the desiccant breather, and the breather was exhausted. It went to a color that they weren't supposed to go to because they aren't changing them. Well, if you don't change them, if you're not going to replace them and keep them clean and keep them dry, there's no use having them on there. Just take them off and let it vent to atmosphere. So these are all things you need to look at when you're looking at housekeeping in your plant. How dirty is your operation? Many of the operations I go into, there's high particle counts, there's high moisture due to the process, and we have to figure out in lubrication excellence how do we eliminate those failure modes. And when you do, I've got plants that have operations with high foreign material failures or high foreign material counts around all their bearings, and they've installed automatic lubers, and their mean time between failure before putting those on was 6 to 8 months. I've got one plant in Chicago right now. They've got 4 years on some bearings they were losing that the former mean time between failure was 6 to 8 months. So, again, huge successes can be made with lubrication excellence. Your automatic lube systems. You know, I always look around plants. Are you using any automatic lubers, whether they're battery-powered or gas-powered? You know, I do a whole training section in my lubrication excellence training on automatic lubers. When I ran a plant, I had my guys, we tested every automatic luber that was known to man with all different kind of greases under conditions where we stuck them in an oven at 120 degrees, we stuck them in a freezer, we stuck them in dry ice because those were the conditions in my plant during the winter and the summer. You know, there was 100 degree days and some of the areas were 110, 115 degrees. Then we had winter days where it was minus 20. We wanted to know if these automatic lubers were going to work through all those conditions, so we tested them all. But they're very important in a lubrication excellence, and some of the things that an automatic luber will do for you, they actually work in places where maintenance people don't like to go, to the top of a 130-foot bucket elevator, back in a dark, dirty tunnel where there's a lot of dust. The other thing they do for you, if you're using regular greasing cycles with a grease gun and somebody's putting a grease gun on that greaser every week, if you put an automatic luber on there, we eliminate those particles that the maintenance guy's pumping into that bearing every week. And now you know, and of course you know that the component is getting grease. So a lot of good applications in lubrication excellence for automatic lubrication systems. Foreign material sealing. You know, if you have foreign material, you know, one of your practices is doing the root cause analysis and finding out how that material can get in there. Can we eliminate or can we do a better job of sealing? Can we use Labra seals? And I've got maintenance guys that get real creative with this, creating their own seals and covers to keep contaminants, keep foreign material out of their critical high-dollar components. Very important with a lubrication excellence program to look at those kind of issues. Here's a chart here I put in there. This is a hydraulic system oil. If you look down the left side of this chart, you'll take one, and this is an ISO code at a plant I was at in Alabama just a few months ago. Here's an ISO code of 20, 22, 19, 17. This is what was in their hydraulic system. We put 10 micron beta 1000 filters on that unit. We took the ISO code down to 16, 13, 11, around 5 times more life by just filtering the oil down to this level. Another plant I was at, they had nothing in their plant, not a gearbox, not a bearing, not a hydraulic system that was below these upper levels up here. In fact, a lot of their stuff was too dirty for evaluation. And by getting them in the process of filtering their lubricants down to this 10 micron beta 1000 range, look at the life increase just by filtering the lubes down. Now, Noria has all these charts available that you can use, but you know, this is my version of it. It's similar to the Noria chart, but look at this, 10 times the life by eliminating these particles in your lubricants. Equipment moisture control. Again, we have all these moisture issues, whether you're in an area where it's high humidity, which could be a lot of the U.S. during the summer. You know, if you have in a food plant where you have washdown and CIP systems going off, you know, are you using desiccant breathers to keep this moisture out? Are we putting better filters or better seals on components? You know, Cargill back in the 2003, you know, had Toshiba develop them a Toshwash motor that had special seals on the motor to keep water from getting into the motor. And they were basically Labra seals. Well, this eliminated a lot of failures in the plants because of this, just putting these Labra seals on their electric motors in a food plant. In fact, it was a turkey processing plant. But huge effort in lubrication excellence to make sure these motors didn't fail. Now look at this chart for moisture. If you only have 1,000 parts per million of moisture in your water, and we can reduce that to 50, 6 times the life of your component, of your bearing or gearbox, just taking the moisture level from 1,000 to 50. Now you say, well, that's going to be hard to do. I've got to have special filters. I've got to have all this. Well, what's the cost of downtime? And in my training, I give you a number of different ways that you can use different systems such as dry air, such as nitrogen. There's a lot of different ways to get this moisture out of the oil after it's in your oil in your plant. You know, Descase makes a vacuum dehydrator for lubrication oils for big volume, but you know, I can show you some easy, cheap ways with equipment you already have in your plant to reduce these moistures in your equipment. But a huge life extension by following the moisture lubrication excellence. You know, lubrication excellence interest in your plant. You know, I always try to talk to people and try to find out in your plant. I remember at the plant that I ran for years, I did lubrication training with all 12 guys in the maintenance group, and I found a couple guys that were really interested in it. Other guys thought it was cool, shrugged their shoulders, and went back and did what they did for the last 20 years, but I had a couple young guys that were interested. You know, getting somebody interested in lubrication at your plant will save you huge dollars. You know, that when I left that plant, the highest paid person in maintenance there was the lube technician. And the reason for that is because he added the most value to the life cycles of the plant of anybody in maintenance, because we were removing particles, we were removing moisture, we started seeing these longer equipment component lives. So it's huge to find out what the interest is and develop that interest through some of the things that I did. I had maintenance people test automatic lubers. We tested different filters. We cut filters open and looked at them. So you develop that interest. People want to know what's going on, what the things they're doing. Oil filtration system. You know, very few people, when I go into plants, they bought a Parker filter car, they buy a filter car from somebody, they say they've got 10 micron beta 1000 filters on there. I ask them, I said, what's your ISO code after filtering? They tell me, and I always tell them, well, that's not what you have in there. Your vendor sold you something that's not what they say it is. And so I get them to the right vendor. I teach them what the beta numbers actually mean. I teach them what the efficiency numbers of those filters actually are. And once we start filtering our lubricants down to the proper particles, or the proper size particles, or a lot of times I've got plants that take them down to virtually no particles, down to 1 or 3 microns, you start seeing these longer equipment lives. But we have to understand with lubrication excellence what these filters are and how to size our filters for this proper filtration. And this is something else we can do some other training on with future webinars is lube filtration. Lube oil analysis. You know, what a very important part of lubrication excellence, especially on critical equipment. We want to sample the oil. We want to know what's in it. We want to know if the additives that the vendor says he put in there is in there. If they were in there originally, we want to know if they're in there 6 months from now, see if your equipment's actually consuming the additives. But I go into plants all the time where they're doing oil analysis. they're looking at the oil analysis results, and the example was the plant I told you about just a few minutes ago that had all these things that were just about off the chart. All the ISO codes real high, and they said they didn't know what the ISO code actually meant or where it should go, so we set goals. And but, you know, getting trained on oil analysis and getting the right people to sample your products, your oil products, is going to be key to extending your equipment life and keeping your lubricants in good condition. Wear particle analysis, another technology that's on my list there, different than oil analysis, because now we have these particles in there. Well, what are the particles? Are they steel from bearings? Are they foreign material from your process? Are they foreign material from the process next door? You know, is it something your lube vendor delivers? I was at a plant one time where the bulk delivery truck came up there and pumped lubricants into the tank. I took a sample, and the sample's full of silica dust, because the truck's driving around in the middle of the state with the covers not on and no desiccant breathers, and they're delivering dirty oil to the customer. So we have to understand what these particles are. You know, it's high in particles. What are they? Is it my dirt, your dirt? Where'd it come from? Training programs, you know, key in lubrication excellence. Everyone needs to understand about all these things we just talked about today. This is step 20. It should probably be step 1. Make sure you get the proper training. Make sure everybody understands these lubrication failure modes, and then you can start developing your program. Here's a lube storage room that we built for a company that makes Coke, and not Coca-Cola, but the Coke for steel processing. Very, very dirty environment. A lot of issues there with their lubrication filtration. This company here can set their 55-gallon drums in this room. Each one of these pumps has a dual 10-micron beta 1000 filter. They can pump them into the containers you see at the far end of the building there and keep their lubes clean. The room's air-conditioned and heated and controlled atmosphere to store their drums. Now, we talk about safety of lubricants. This is one of the things that comes up all the time, and I was working with a company in California just this morning. You know, the insurance guy came in and he called me and says, why did you sell this customer a lube room with plastic tanks and they're storing flammable chemicals? Well, lubricants are not flammable liquids. They're class 3B fluids, and a class 3B fluid is any fluid that has a vapor or flash point above 200 degrees. Well, if you pull out your lubrication specification sheet, you'll see that lubricants have flash points and fire points at from 465 to 525 degree F. Well, it takes a huge fire to get a lubricant to that temperature where it'll burn. So lubricants are safe to store. And this one here, when I have to go over this with an insurance guy or a fire department, there's a big lack of understanding of what lubricants are and what they're classified as. So lube storage is very safe. You know, many of my customers don't even hook up the sprinkler lines or don't even hook up the dry chemical lines when they're in these rooms, because they understand that as long as they keep flammable liquids out of there, as long as they eliminate any small fires in that room, the lubricants will never catch on fire. So just a little safety thing I threw in there for you. As you're designing your lube storage room, you know, lubricants are safe to store. So again, the payback in this, eliminating these lubrication issues, can add many, many life cycles to your equipment. You've seen just from some of the charts, reducing particles, 3 to 8 times life we can increase on our hydraulic systems and bearings. Lowering the moisture. You know, sometimes it's easy to lower the moisture, get 2 or 3 times a life, but you just saw in one example in that chart, you can get 6 to 8 times a life depending on what your moisture levels are. So what's this going to get for you? You know, reduced downtime, higher rates, lower energy cost, extended equipment life. They're just a few of the benefits. Now, I'm going to be doing a lubrication excellence training at the Reliability Show for UE this year. I'm hoping some of you are going to be there to see that. It covers all these things in a 4-hour session or an 8-hour session. But you can see the payback is huge if we can reduce 50% of our failures in our plants. So some key points: understand ISO cleanliness codes, test your new oils and lubes in your plant, and understand what those codes are telling you. Lower those codes down, you know, set some cleanliness codes for your plant, start lowering those ISO cleanliness codes down your plant, and you will start seeing longer equipment life. You know, critical equipment needs even cleaner and drier lubes. You know, on the space shuttle, I talked to a guy from NASA one time, and they filter the lubes on the space shuttle down to submicron levels, because he told me when they're up in space at that low temperature, if there's a 10-micron particle in the lube, it can jam up the servo valve on the shuttle. So you can see all these things can be done, and all these things are understood by when you're talking about critical equipment. You know, get training on lubrication excellence and lube oil filtration. And look at proper lube receiving and storage. This is where a lot of our failure modes are coming from, in the way we receive the lube, the way we store the lube, and the way we care for it throughout our process. So again, that's the end of my presentation. If you have questions, you know, you can email me. You can look at the website, rpslive.com. There's a lot of information on the UE website. We've talked about lubrication a lot on their website, so check out some of those webinars and feel free to shoot me an email or check the website out if you need any further information.
All right. Well, thanks, Terry. And we did have a few questions come in, so let me read some of these to you. And obviously, folks, you know, if you're thinking of other questions, please feel free to write those in. So one person wrote the following. I am currently having issues with our gravity-fed oilers, chain oilers, I think is what they meant. My main issue is the brushes. What other options are there? Silicone bristle brushes or just taking them off completely? Spray type oilers that are battery powered, et cetera, et cetera. So just looking for some feedback from you there.
Yeah, well, one of the big issues there is a lot of times where they're installed and the temperature change. And if you remember the viscosity curve at one of the plants we went to, we actually switched the oiler on those to synthetic oil because that's what was happening to him. It was, you know, it was 30, 40 degrees hotter during some parts of the day than others. And then the other thing, there is a lot of options on the application brushes, on different ways you can apply the oil to there. So, you know, for me to say which one's the best, I don't know what the application is, but there are a lot of variables out there on the types of brushes and the different kinds of applicators. I mean, we've taken them off at a lot of plants and let it drip on there and use the right viscosity so it stays on the component.
All right. Next question. And they said thank you, so that obviously helped them out. Okay, this person said, our plant seems to have a lot of water forming in motors and gearboxes. The cause seems to be condensation. Do you have any experience in correction, particularly with motors?
Yeah, motors is a little tough, but one of the things we did at Cargill for motors is we started ordering our motors or buying our motors with Labra seals on the shafts, and that keeps a lot of moisture out. The other thing is one of the reasons we grease electric motors and keep that cavity full in the front is to keep moisture from getting in there, because the grease a lot of times is not there for the bearings because the bearings are sealed. But by keeping that cavity full, we keep moisture out of the motors. Now, for gearboxes and hydraulic units, one of the things you can do if you have dry compressed air, and Donaldson sells something called a dry pack, but you can bleed dry compressed air through the airspace of a gearbox or a hydraulic unit, and the dry air will actually take the moisture out of the lubricant while it's running, and it'll actually keep moisture from coming in. So just a couple quick ones there.
All right, great. And folks, you know, feel free to put keep sending those in. Somebody was wondering, and you did touch on it a little bit, but maybe talk just a bit more on your thoughts about automatic lubers.
Oh, yeah, I think the automatic lubers are key for any lubrication excellence program. There's applications in every facility I've been at, and some of those applications could be dirty environments. They can be high moisture environments. They're hard to reach places. You should have those on there. And then the nice thing about the automatic lubers, when I put them on, I always recommend they go to synthetic greases in those automatic lubers. Now, the only way to know what the rate of the automatic luber is to use something like UE or ultrasonics to determine what the frequency really needs to be and what the volume really needs to be. So whenever I go into plants and help them size their automatic lubers, I have to have a UE tool with me in order to do that, because a lot of times we grease bearings once a week, and I find out at some plants that bearing needs a little bit of grease every day and a half. Well, your options there are to change your PMs and lube it every day and a half with a smaller amount, or figure out that volume and frequency and use an automatic luber in that application.
All right. Well, that seems to be all the questions. Oh, wait. Someone just popped one in. Okay. And all right. So this one is in reference to the grease caddy. So they're wondering, when does one stop pumping as he listens to the process via headphones? Does he stop pumping as the noise goes away, or do you wait a bit, or what exactly is the process? So we'll test you on your grease caddy knowledge.
Okay, my experience with the grease caddy is as soon as the noise goes away. Now, if the dial actually works, I wait for it to go to green, but as soon as the noise goes away, I stop lubing. And if that noise comes back within 2 or 3 minutes, the bearing is normally bad. But I always stop as soon as the noise goes away. That tells you got the right amount of lube in the bearing.
All right. And now people are getting fired up now. Okay, so here's another one. What are your thoughts about using condition-based lubrication PM strategy, like ultrasonic surveys, instead of time-based PM strategies for greasing?
Yeah, well, there's no science behind the time-based. I mean, if you look at what the way things were done in the 70s and 80s and 90s, where vendors would send you a little PM, or you're sending your PM procedures, and they would say this bearing needs to be lubed every week or every month. There's a lot of variables in how often a bearing needs greased. And, you know, if one of those is temperature, one of them is load, speed, the environmental conditions. So for me to say for anybody's bearing you should grease that size bearing every week, I have to know all those conditions. And I can send people a little chart, or I can have you guys post something on your website about all the conditions or all the circumstances I look at when I determine grease frequencies. Because I don't think the vendors, most of the time, they give you some general ballpark, but I don't think they really understand what your applications are. So a lot of variables go into how often and how much.
All right, and here's another one. So how much time do you think is required to do a really good job training a mechanical technician with about five years of experience to get them up to speed on all of this?
It's usually the course I recommend is the four-hour course. I do these publicly, and I also go into plants, and I train all the maintenance guys. But, I mean, you can get a real good training program and get through all these fundamentals in a four-hour course.
So perfect. You're doing that four-hour course at our Reliable Asset World in May. So great place to send your mechanics and your technicians to come on down to Clearwater, Florida for that four-hour course, and they'll be good to go, it sounds like. So that's cool. Yep. Love how that worked out. Okay, some more questions came in. Wow, they're really flying in now. People are waking up. Okay. Would you continue to grease a motor if there are no signs of leakage or no increase in vibration readings? Obviously talking about making sure we're not over-greasing. So.
Right. Well, my philosophy on greasing motors is this. You should grease the motor on some regular interval, depending on the size of the motor, the speed of the motor, and those conditions, but you should always take the drain plug out or put one of those little reliefs on there, because what you're trying to do is keep fresh grease in that cavity for two reasons: to keep the particles and any contamination from getting in, and also if that bearing ever does need grease, that grease is available there. But I know a lot of plants I go to, they grease motors without taking the bottom plug out, without purging all the old grease out, and as you grease that motor, that grease is going to go somewhere. It's usually going to go into the motor. So, but I still believe in greasing, not all motors, but critical motors, or motors that are in critical environments. I greasing those on some regular frequency, like monthly or every 3 months.
All right. Here's one. Can you add grease to double shielded bearings, such as motor bearings?
No, you can't get the grease in, but what I like to do with double-shielded motor bearings is have the grease available outside that shield. And that's why I like to grease the motors on a regular interval, so the grease is available outside the shield, because when that bearing starts failing, that shield is going to, a lot of times will fall out, or it's going to get hot enough that some of the grease will meld into that bearing. It'll get in there somehow. So I like to have the grease available outside that double shield.
All right, and let's see, they're really flying in. Okay, what would you say to someone who says that they over-lubricate their bearings in order to push debris out of the bearing housings?
Yep, well, I actually, in some of my plants, I've got a plant that's got a very, very dirty environment. Now, we do this with automatic lubers. We slightly over-grease those bearings to keep any particles or moisture from getting in. And we're able to adjust the automatic luber. But I've actually done that at plants, especially when the seals are blown on the bearing, slightly over-grease them to keep, you don't push it. You push particles out if you've got wear particles in there. That helps a lot. But, yeah, there are applications where you need to do that.
Okay.
It's not a recommended practice for every bearing.
All righty. Okay, here's one. Hi, Terry. I'm new to the industry and working at a sawmill, obviously very dirty and dusty environment. Which improvement area do you think has the best bang for the buck? Moisture, particles, etc. There's so many. Where's a good place to start?
Well, you know, a good place to start there is, again, is doing a survey and finding out what all those different failure modes are, because we already know we have particles, we already know we have moisture. The very next thing to do is look at what is the most critical pieces of equipment, what are going to cost you the most in downtime if they fail, you know, what are they going to cost, you know, what's the cost of the component, things like that, and attack those first, try to get clean, dry lubricants in those, and then just move down your system.
All right. And actually, Terry, I think it was maybe last year, you did a webinar for us on performing asset criticality analysis. So that webinar is up on our website, so that might be something to check out as you're to the person that asked that question as you're getting into this this process. Okay, let's see. A couple more here. This person says, putting air into an oil bath system, wouldn't that be adding the third part of the fire triangle? So not really I guess that's not quite a question.
If it's a high temperature hydraulic system, that would probably be right. But like I say, your lube oils are not going to create any flash or anything until they get up to around above 400 degrees. I don't think anybody's got any hydraulic systems that are running at that temperature. So if you put the only reason I use the dry air and hydraulic systems is if you have a moisture problem, and you don't have to keep it on there all the time, but you can add some dry air, and I'm talking about having it bent off at like maybe just 1 or 2 CFM. But I was able to, in a hydraulic system at a plant, we took a Donaldson dry pack, we ran it on a reservoir that had 100 gallons of hydraulic oil in it. The oil moisture level when we started was 1,320 parts per million. We let the dry pack on there for 12 hours, came back in the next morning, and it was down to 53 parts per million. So I use it to get moisture out. If you got a lot of moisture, and I've actually put nitrogen, I mean, nitrogen is another system you can use on a gearbox down in Louisiana, where we put nitrogen pressure on it. Nitrogen actually dried the oil out, and it also kept moisture and particles from coming into the gearbox.
All right. Okay, let's see. So kind of this one goes a little bit back to kind of the question about the grease caddy and how to know when to stop pumping. So, and you mentioned, you know, when the sound goes away, but someone wants to know, well, what if it never goes away and you've pumped, you know, what you think is a lot of grease in there and that's just not, it's not doing anything.
Yeah, I think Doug will tell you the same thing. If the sound doesn't go away, the bearing is bad and lubrication is not going to do anything for you anyway. Because the sound's being generated, not always, but the sound's being generated mostly by the wear of the bearing.
So no need to keep wasting that grease. Just stop. No,
you may want to keep putting it in there to keep the bearing running until you can change it, but most of the time in those cases, that bearing's already bad.
All right. Okay. Well, that was it. A little bit like a firing squad there.
That's good.
But that's good. So. Good questions. Obviously, you see Terry's information here. You guys know how to get in touch with us. So if you're thinking of things after we log off here, certainly continue to send those in. Terry, I appreciate you taking the time today. I've got a couple closeout slides here, so I'm just going to take the screen back from you if you don't mind.
Okay. Nope, go ahead.
All right. So, as I stated quite a few times throughout, we've got a ton of information up on our website, and maybe we will even take Terry up on his offer to have him send some of the materials he referenced so we can put them up there. Of course, you can always go to his website as well. But we do encourage you to visit uesystems.com. You can find out all kinds of information, obviously, about what you can do with ultrasound as it relates to lubrication, and, of course, the other applications as well, leak detection, electrical inspections, and so on. We've got all of our training information up there as well. We've got a lot of level one classes coming up all over the country and the globe, actually. We're holding one in Kuala Lumpur next week. So lots of opportunities to get that certification training on ultrasound. We've also got the steam trap examiner courses. I think we've got those on the schedule for a little later in the year. just some ways you can stay connected with us throughout the month. We've got our LinkedIn groups, UltraProbe Users Group, Reliable Asset World Group, so feel free to go, and if you're not already a member of those, just request to join and we'll get you in there. Lots of great conversations taking place there. It's always a good place to even take the questions that you've got remaining from a webinar you've sat in on, and throw it out there to the community, see what kinds of things other people are doing at their facilities, and kind of get that peer-to-peer connection. We're on Twitter. We've got our UE Systems blog, so check all of that out as well. And as you heard us mention a couple times, we've got our big conferences coming up in, geez, now just like about 7 weeks or so. Reliable Asset World and Ultrasound World 10. We're going to be down in Clearwater, Florida, May 13 through 16. Encourage you to check those out. We've got business justification letters up on the website, so if you need help getting that approval, check those out. And we've got some webinars that we did that sort of did a kind of a sneak peek of what's to come at those events, so those will be a great way to really get you excited about coming down. So hopefully you can be there, and as I said, Terry will be doing his 4-hour lubrication excellence workshop for us down there, so that'll be really great. I'll leave our contact information up here so you guys can jot that down. Any questions that come in, Terry, we'll get those to you so you can get those taken care of, get those folks their answers after the fact. And, again, appreciate everybody taking the time today. I appreciate people understanding the slight technical issues we had yesterday, but I think the wait was well worth it for what you shared today, Terry. So thanks again, and I hope everybody has a great rest of the day, a great weekend, and we'll see you next month.